Hi, Kevin here. I want to do a Facebook Live broadcast about creativity. I've been thinking about this a lot, and people have asked me lately more and more for my definition of creativity and for the importance of creativity, and the more people ask me, the more I want to ask other people for their opinions about this, because I hate just saying what I think. So I'm hoping that some more people will jump into this conversation and add yes, ideas and things they want to say in the chat window, but also add links to definitions, add links to videos you make during this broadcast, add to this conversation so that when people come back to this, Chaparral, hey, thank you, Carla, that's very nice, I appreciate that. Oh, the kitty, hi, kitty, kitty. She was really mad that I stole this chair, so she's decided to I think, just kind of bully me out of the chair by just hanging out over my shoulder. So anyway, back to the conversation. I want this conversation to be about creativity and a couple of things. I don't care if it gets broad. It's fine if it gets broad. What is creativity? Is it important that we try to develop creativity? Yes, yes. Jim, I always have to grow the beard back, but sometimes you got to shave it off so it doesn't look so Grizzly Adams, so it doesn't look so grizzly. So once a year I try to do that. Hey, baby. Okay, so is it important that we encourage and try to develop creativity in kids, and if so, why? Why? Is it something schools should address? Is it? Do you think it's going to be important in the future? So you can just make statements. You can say, I think creativity is going to be important in the future. Link and shoot that off to some article that you found somewhere, some research that you found somewhere, something. Basically, what I'd like is if people watch this and look at the links and look at the comments, they could really have a good start in this conversation about creativity. So what is creativity? What is creativity? Anyone want to chime in here on that? What do you think creativity is? What is creativity? And I'm not the verifier, the validator here. I'm not here to tell you that you're right. I have some ideas. Inspiration expressed. That's pretty good. That's pretty good in my opinion. Let me frame it that way. Again, creativity. Can you define creativity? I think you can. I think creativity is that sort of activity, that sort of errand where you find yourself trying to come up with a new idea. Hey, Treva, how's it going? A new idea or a new approach or a new vision of some kind to invent. See, I think a lot of times we in the fine arts, and I being a K-12 arts teacher for much of my career with a major in fine arts, I have ideas about what creativity is and what creativity isn't. Jim says, allow students to scaffold their knowledge to develop products that are meaningful to them. They can be inspired by what they are passionate about. That sounds great. I like that definition, Jim. I like that. See, in an art classroom, there are freedoms, not open-ended freedoms. This is something that I've been interested in lately, is to what extent total freedom is important and to what extent it's possible that some limitations actually encourage creativity. In other words, if you have every choice in the world, is it possible that you struggle more to be creative than if you have some limitations and you have to problem solve and come up with ideas within the constraints of that situation? And more I'm finding that I believe that being inside the box constantly helps you get outside the box more effectively. In other words, if we all start outside the box, there's no structure. There's nothing to build from. Trish Camp right now, I hope that she's being inspired in different ways. Yeah, I hope she is too. We hope our kids are, you know, and there's something, Treva, about Rubrics restrict creativity. I think so too. I think rubrics are a way that a non-creative person can feel like they've built something meaningful. But a rubric pretty much says we're all going to do the same thing, which to me is the antithesis of individual creativity. If we're graded on a rubric that one person came up with, then basically the thing's been defined already. I never wanted to be a part of something that I knew had an outcome that was already measurable before I even did it. I never wanted to use a textbook that was signed 5 times by the people who had it 5 years before me, and I know I'm the 6th year on the same knowledge, and nothing new has been added. That would always bother me. So creativity, again, and Sarah, we're having this sort of open-ended conversation about what we think creativity is, what creativity isn't. Is creativity important in schools? Should we be encouraging, and I don't say teaching, I don't think you can teach creativity, I think you can make conditions favorable for creativity. I think it can happen in makerspaces, depending on the makerspace. I think just because you have a makerspace doesn't mean that you're being creative there. I think a makerspace can be a great place to do three-dimensional worksheets, basically just sort of, yeah, do spurn the development of other avenues of creativity. Spurn and spur, in a way. I've seen it happen in every form of art, from African children building instruments, from anything. So many different... This is an interesting conversation there, Jeff. New coding comes from a need or limitations. I think it's limitations and challenges make people invent. And I think in a world of artists, if you look at art, you go back to look at all art, you know, in all movements, the Impressionists had something they were trying to solve. They were trying to paint light. They were trying to paint light in the moment, right? Specific light. And different Impressionists did different studies of light through the day as the sun went overhead. And they were trying to capture the way light reflects off of things. I mean, this was a very... hard thing for the human eye and the human hand to accomplish, and yet they did in a very interesting way with the Impressionist movement, and so many different ways they were able to do that. The Cubists come, you know, along, and they're looking at trying to capture time. Like, let's say nude descending staircase or nude descending the stairs, and if you Google that, you could end up anywhere, so be careful. But what that painting is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 views of that person coming down the stairs. Now, to paint all of that into one painting is impossible, right? But to try to paint it on one painting is amazing, right? What the Cubists really did was they sort of pre-saw what motion pictures were going to do. And I think that's very interesting. What is creative to you might not be creative to me. We need to allow students to express themselves so they can become more engaged in their learning. I agree with that. And I think the problem is you can become so versed in what you think your idea of creativity is that you can't make room for someone else's creativity. That is to say, and it's The Curse of Knowledge, an interesting book to read called The Curse of Knowledge, is that we can become so versed in our version of what we think things are that we cannot make room for a new version. We sort of stand in the way of other people coming along with new ideas, right? I read the poets to sort of get ideas, and Emerson's one of my favorites, and he has so many different poems of the artist and the poet that I find very, very interesting. Shown all the time in her art and her drawings, her inspiration comes from her dad. I missed some of that, but I'll go back and catch it later. Hey, Jim. And Jennifer Thiessen is here. Hi, Jennifer Thiessen. So back to creativity. So let's talk about creativity with regard to some different forms of aesthetic. Okay. So visual art creativity. This painting back here behind me is a painting that I did in a black frame, and my friend Matt framed it for me and did a great job making this frame. It hangs over my fireplace here at my house. I painted this a long time ago. And this is hard edge abstract, what you see here. And I'm not selling it. I don't have a bunch of these to sell. I'm not marketing anything here. But if you look at this painting, I came to call Tornadic Landscape. And that's after I painted it. I didn't paint this thinking of tornadoes crossing a landscape. I accidentally made this seem like a landscape from the air. I don't know if I can help you see it closer or not with my current camera setup, Treva. I'm not sure, but if you can full screen this at the bottom right corner, sometimes there's a full screen, not sure if there is or not. Anyway, what I was painting here is layers and layers of experience and emotion. This all sounds fluffy, I know, but I was trying to paint straight from my feelings. I would call it abstract expressionism, right? And I had a teacher who said, do this, just do this. And there's, sorry about the glare. Like in my picture right now, I can't see the glare. The glare could be my painting, Treva. I may have painted the glare into it. I'm not sure. Anyway, back to this, okay? Because I did like 20 paintings in this series here. And what I was painting is just life experience, memories, things like that. This whole show was called Layers, right? And so was it creative? Was it creativity? Was this creativity? People look at it and go, oh my gosh, it's so creative, because they don't know where to put it. They don't have a place in their mind where this thing fits easily. And so they make this assumption closet that they throw it into. And I think a lot of people do that, that they have this idea of creativity being something outside of what they could possibly do. They think all musicians are amazing and wonderful, when a lot of what you do as a musician or as a visual artist is technique. Technique combined with inspiration becomes something new. And I would say that whenever you're making something that no one has ever seen before, you're making something that could be creative. Now, does it mean it has value? Not necessarily to the culture. Does it have a value to the artist? Sometimes, right? Is this process where one imagines, makes, reflects, and does it again important? I guess that's a question. Is it important in schools? Do we want our kids to have the capacity to do new things, to make new things, to create new things? Not just to copy, not just to comply, but to make something new, you know? So I think a lot of times we get so busy that what constitutes creativity is seen as optional while we do things that we think are more important. But I think a lot of times we measure the value of education based pretty strictly on some measurable things, while some people that I really look up to and read their blogs would say that creativity is really hard to measure. And therefore, we're left to our own devices when it comes to how to measure creativity. I would agree with some of that. I think if there's output, if creativity would seem to be saying create, right? To create. I think if you're in school 4 years and painted one painting, not a lot of output happened, therefore not a lot of creativity happened. It might be an amazing painting, but it's one. I think until kids start to have a resume, start to have a portfolio, not a whole lot of content has come out. So I think if you think about, like, let's say that Jennifer Miller Pugsley, Jennifer Christine Miller Pugsley is teaching a kid how to play guitar or cello or a stringed instrument. Well, I mean, at some point, parents are going to want to measure how many songs does she know? How many things can she do? How much technique has she learned? How far has she come in her pursuit? Now, is that creativity? Copying scales, probably not creative yet. I think there's accidental creativity that comes in the difference between what someone shows you and what you're able to do. See, I think a lot of people try to copy exactly what they've learned. Like, they're almost like cameras. They look at a picture and they try to be a camera. And maybe they're photo real. Maybe it's so real that it looks just like the house. Well, are you creative or are you a camera? At that point, what are you? I think it's all the ways that it's not exactly like it looks that identify the human that painted it, the hand that painted it. So if I play a song on my guitar by another musician, it's all the ways it doesn't sound like Jackson Browne, all the ways it doesn't sound like John Denver, but still sounds aesthetically pleasing. That might make it live in a realm of creativity. Now, if you want to give creativity a wide berth, lots of room. You could say, well, everything they do is creative, whatever they do, because they're learning. And that's beautiful. That's beautiful. But don't send them out into the world with that, because it's going to be hard. We've all seen it, you know, in awful, evil places like American Idol, where people think they're better than they are. and then they go find out that they're not as good. I think that's a cruel thing to do. I think it's, if you're helping kids learn something new, like music, for instance, I think it comes from the heart. I think that's a good definition, Treva. I think a lot of people would struggle to know what that means exactly. I think there's a faith in a creative place in children when they're little that is easily extinguished by systems like public schooling or by proper instruction by maybe a master who only sees one way of doing things and might step on a kid's other way. I'd like to be inclusive with kids because I want to make room for that outlier, that unicorn, that person that plays totally wrong. Those kids clog up American Idol. I think that's the entertainment, Jeff. I think people, it's like the way people can't take their eyes off a car wreck. I think watching someone die in front of a camera is a terribly intriguing and very human thing to look at. I think it's mean, but creativity, then limitations. I hate to say it rules. Rules, yeah, but every art form that I've seen has elements and principles that are sort of the rules of that art form. Now, people bend the rules, break the rules. Impressionists came along, and what was it they called? The purists called their big exhibit the Salon des Refuses, which means the salon or of trash, because they couldn't make room for that being different. You know, Woodstock happens, and all these musicians that the classical musicians might call wanting. Yet they came along and sort of defended and sort of identified an outpost of creativity that took over the popular culture. Looking forward to seeing you in a couple of weeks. Woohoo! Is creativity different for different people and students? We would celebrate all creativity. And this is interesting. Karen's talking to us from Australia. And as I go to different countries and talk to people about creativity, I find that creativity and the definition of creativity varies some, but I think for most people there is an understanding that creativity is important, that creativity is probably where innovation and invention comes from. And if you're a fan of us puzzling our way through these current world problems, then you should be a fan, I think, of creativity. And I don't just mean in art. See, a lot of people will say it's art and arts and crafts. I mean, I think a lot of people really struggle with this definition of what creativity is. And I think we can all have our own ideas, and please post links to better definitions. But let me take a stab at a definition. Creativity, the act of making, visioning, or creating something new, maybe I'm done. Something new, something that hasn't been seen, something the world hasn't seen. For instance, if you study hieroglyphs and you start doing a kind of impressionist painting that includes hieroglyphic imagery, now you've got a modern take on an ancient art, right? And if those two things have never been juxtaposed in one picture for people to see and think about, then you've probably done something creative. I once knew an artist who collected baseball cards, and he was hardcore baseball card artist. And then he started painting those baseball cards and these huge paintings. By the way, I'm so jealous because he sold them like hotcakes, of course. Sports memorabilia people paid big money for his paintings. So he caught on to something that people found very interesting. Were they creative? They were creative with regard to the impressionist way that he painted them. They did not look like real baseball cards, but you could still tell they were baseball cards. And that chasm between what baseball cards looked like and what he made, that was that sort of realm of creativity in which he lived, probably there. So let's talk about musical creativity for a minute. Okay. So this is my 12-string guitar here. Okay. Let me scooch my chair back just a little bit. So what's it mean to be creative with music? I usually start somewhere where I'm copying or emulating someone else. And then I look for something, like a seam or an abyss, a place in between, where I can make something similar but different. And this is like inventing, but not really inventing, but making an improvement to an existing invention. So many songs are written in the same four chords, or largely in the same four chords. They're not really innovating as far as the chords that they're playing. They're innovating as far as the words that they're using and the way that they're singing against those chords there, and the way they're harmonizing, and just a feel, a take, a stylistic timing approach. All of that stuff is the sort of milieu of that musical sort of freedom in which you can be creative. That doesn't mean see you later, Treva. Always fun to hear from you. That doesn't mean that in a class we have every sound in the world and we hope music happens there. I think the class could be a guitar class, and within that guitar class we do chords and we do progressions and we do scales, and within all of those scales and things, kids find creativity within some of those structures. That doesn't mean some crazy outlier doesn't invent some new way to play upside down and backwards and actually knows no chords. And how many of those people do you see on YouTube and go, oh my gosh, that person has no idea that they can't, therefore they do. And I believe that's something. A guy once told me that he loved Americans because Americans didn't know they couldn't, they just did. And I really at that time believed that's who we were. And then I started thinking that we started copying other people, trying to turn our schools into other people's models, and we forgot our birthright, which was largely that we were creative. We've been creative. It was a bunch of Americans who, you know, envisioned the internet and started working on that. And then if you look at a bunch of things that were sort of born here, like Pixar, like Steve Jobs, like some of the things that were made in the 80s and 90s and go back to the 60s, I think there's just a whole lot of cultural freedom here that makes it possible to have crazy ideas and not get shot down. Not to say that some systems that seem like they have so much control, they would be like wearing a straitjacket, haven't spawned some of the most creative movements ever. There's something about that. There's something about being in prison that makes, I believe, fosters a sort of freedom in here. And I've seen this in prison art. I've seen this in inmate art. I look at inmate art, and there's something about knowing you've got 16 years that stretches out the human experience into a kind of patience that is very interesting. So I wouldn't say that you have to have this or you have to have that. I think what you do have to have in a system is a value for creativity, a place to put that. And if you're not sure where to put that because you've struggled with this, and art teachers out there, I feel, hey, it's good to see you, Tabitha, what's up? I feel for the art teachers out there that right now are on the chopping block, and they're being seen as optional in a time of high stakes testing, in a time when we're trying to make all kids know the same stuff at the same time on the same day so they can all go to the same college and get the same jobs. But we're watching sort of those kids not get jobs and the sort of end of that sort of artificial promise, and ask any Generation Xer out there what they think of those promises that if you get a great education, you're going to get a good job. Right now, I believe there are some of us out there that are saying we better start getting kids ready and flexible for a changing world. Yes, foundation skills, of course, foundation skills, methods and principles in all things. And you'll find that a lot of those methods and principles are the same across different arts. There are similar things. But the flexibility here to not marry one thing, that if the industry changes and now we're doing fibers instead of metal, instead of sheet metal and rivets, now we're doing high-density plastics, and that's how you make it, so I changed my job skills so I'm still employable. That could be important, and that's not specific. That's a mindset. I will keep learning. I like to say the killer app for the 21st century is kids have to learn to love to learn. It's like too legit to quit. Hey, hey. Learn to love to learn, right? Just kind of fall in love with learning a new thing. So I think that pliability here is important. And also sort of an eye toward what's next. As you look at robotics and you look at AI and you look at what people are predicting is on its way. And I have a lot of friends who work in that field who are a lot better than me at knowing the research. And I'm co-presenting in Australia coming up pretty soon, I think next week, with one of the best thinkers in this space out there. Let me see if I can jump in here and find him on this computer real quick. Hold on a minute. And people throw numbers around. I'm not interested in numbers or specific numbers. I do think that things are going to change. I don't have to be Nostradamus to say that. Things have always changed. And the people who had open minds and embraced the new tool, their descendants usually did better. And the ones who didn't, they became extinct. I've seen that. I've seen that as a student of history. The people who didn't embrace the Clovis point, the spear tip, that still did hand-to-hand combat or with animals, likely their their descendants aren't going to make it in large numbers as the people who embraced that technology and used it. So my question to people is, how are we teaching kids to use current technology to build a life, to build a body of work, to teach themselves, to learn how to learn, right? How do we use all of this stuff, or is it just stuff to play with? I think there are a lot of people who just love new tools. They just love new tools for the sake of the new tools. Anything shiny gets their attention, and it sells. And people love 60 tools in 60 minutes that run through. It's like a shopping spree. But to me, I think the real stuff is, what can we do with all of this cool stuff? What can we do with this stuff here? What can we make? What can we help kids make that help them be successful? Right? And anyone that says they have that figured out is selling something. None of us have that figured out. I do know it's probably important that kids use the tools of their time, because it's always been important that humans use the tools of their time. So let's go back to creativity for a minute. What is creativity with regard to music? You know, I play a chord, and I sort of land myself there. I think, what can I do there? So before I get structural and think about words, I think, well, I've heard that somewhere before. I'm probably copying someone, but I will persist. Okay, so I threw that little slide in there, right? Did it fit? Did I stretch those four traditional chords too far with that? Did I not have enough transition? Did I leave people? Look up at the painting for a minute. If you notice, if you look up there, you'll see 3T9R right there, right? That's on purpose. That's so when people look at the painting, they have some place to land. Anyone can land there. And you can say, oh, I know those numbers. If nothing else makes sense, you have a place to land. You have a place to land. And then you can make your way across and go, oh, this looks like a tornado. Maybe it's a tornado. Oh, this goes like, see the structures there? That's because it would be chaos without that. Like Walt Disney threw up on it. It's just too much. The open-minded people would go, oh, how wonderful. And the rest of the people would go, good gosh, what is that? So I've got to have to sort of walk this line in between or learnable, etc. For me, it can be both if we approach it. I love it. That's beautiful. Jonathan, are you blogging on this somewhere? Hopefully. And if anyone else has bigger ideas on this and has spent some time talking about this, please post links to where you're learning about this and what you're doing about this. I hear a lot of people talk about that innate versus learnable. And I got to believe, Jonathan, I wouldn't have taught this for 13 years if I didn't think it was teachable. I think there are kids who come to you and they think they can't learn it. They learn to be creative, but they've never been given that opportunity. I found that some people who thought they weren't creative at all kind of exploded with creativity and also productivity in the middle of their life. And there are many artists that are famous that everyone knows about who in their 30s finally became an artist. I became a writer in my late 30s. That's when it finally clicked for me. So I do believe that everyone can be creative in some ways. I think that for schools to ignore creativity would be sad, because I think a lot of kids are innately creative, and I think if there's no place for creativity to be valued in a school, then what those kids are isn't valued in the school. So one thing, I think it's important for those kids to be valued and seen, But I also think there should be a place where the creativity is encouraged. And it doesn't mean everyone in my class is going to be creative this year or next year. But if they remember how it felt to be creative, if they remember that they kind of could be creative back then even, when they come back to it in their 30s and they absolutely need that, they'll have it. It's like a gift you give them that just keeps going down the road. So let's say your music is interesting, because if you're writing lyrics and you're playing it in a bed of sort of music, okay, so you got lyrics and music, you're co-joining two things, and the way they juxtapose is very interesting, the juxtaposition of those two things. So words like is it Tim McGraw? I'm not sure, but this song here, I bet you never heard old Marshall Dillon say, just that much. I bet you never heard old Marshall Dillon say, G, D, C, D, and G. A lot got said just now. I bet you never heard old Marshall Dillon say. Now he's going to add what he said, right? So he prompted his own next part. Miss Kitty, have you ever thought of running away? And all of us who ever watched Gunsmoke are going, yeah, he'd never say that. Right? Miss Kitty, have you ever thought of running away? And settling down, would you marry me? If I asked you twice and beg you pretty please. Which she would never have done any of that, right? And what would she have said? She'd have said yes, yes, in a New York minute. Right? And he just goes on. So he's unfolding this story with chords that go with it very well. And it's kind of upbeat and moving fast. So he's making his point quickly. And he gets all the way to the chorus, right? He just stole a kiss as he rode away. He never hung his hat up at Kitty's place. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. I should have been a cowboy. Now, suddenly it's this. Thank you, Toby Keith. Thank you, Jennifer. Thank you. See how he's kind of going along slow, and then suddenly on the chorus, it's the same four chords, but it feels different. Almost like it's galloping, almost like it's on a horse, almost like all of those little tasty nuances that you don't even know. All right, a lot of people who aren't musicians wouldn't even know any of that. They're not literate in that. They just like it. I don't know from art, but I know what I like. That kind of thing there, right? What they're doing is they're taking the elements and principles of music and they're building something that people will enjoy, right? That's ensconced in the sensibilities of its time. That's what artists have always done, right? And there are some artists who don't want to be ensconced in the sensibilities of their time, and they're angry, and they have things to say. You know, who was the artist? Tell me, this is a quiz, and then I'll see if I can remember if it comes to mind. The artist who hung a urinal on the wall and signed it. A urinal in the gallery and signed it and dared anyone to say it wasn't art. What he was basically saying was, if I say it's art, it's art. I'm the artist. You have to trust me. Okay, those people made me nervous, right? Because I'm afraid everyone will stop trusting all artists because they're pushing too far. And I also think the revolutionaries are important because they have the guts to push the envelope, right? And that's what moves us forward as a culture, I think. I have a comfort zone somewhere within that leading edge and bleeding edge, and I'm just behind the people who are being shot. Maybe I'm not as brave as I should be in all fields, because I think the ability to talk to people and to spread a message and to keep moving things forward, the ability to do that is important. And I think if you lose your ability to do that, you can't be a part of the conversation anymore. So maybe when I get old, I'll become that crazy revolutionary. But for now, if you look at music and if you look at the places music's been, from punk to even the Cars, let's say. Okay, so if we look at. No. So there's eighth notes in the Cars, right? It was like a clock ticking, right? It was like a clock ticking. And that's like no big deal, right? I mean, but no one had done that sort of eighth note thing in popular music I hadn't heard anyone do that. And of course, I was in eighth grade when this stuff is going on. But if you look at those eighth notes, let me see if I can find a guitar pick in my pocket here. He's digging in. Let's see. I know I got more in the other room, but let's see what I got. Okay, cool. All right, guitar pick. Okay, so, woo. So someone was sitting there looking for something, and that's what I call it, looking for something. I'm looking for something. I'm fishing in the ether. I'm going to give you my inside story. Okay, what I do personally as an artist, as a creating artist, and what I encourage kids to do. We can be limited and shackled by the realities of our time. In fact, I hate to show kids a model because usually they will accidentally copy the model. I like to talk about a set of problems or a set of proper opportunities, a set of possibilities, and not give them much more than that. Ginger Lumen and I and many others refer to this as optimal ambiguity, not too much structure, so that they can have myriad ways of addressing that particular problem. And that's where I think creativity can happen. I think we can shut it down by trying to water it too much, by giving kids so many good ideas that they have too many ideas and they've forgotten their own ideas. I think these days we have so many tools, we can see so many options, we almost can't pare it down. We can't limit it, right? Get our visor smaller so that we can see how to be creative within just a few things. There's so many things. I would almost say, if you know what pointillism is, pointless pointillism. There's 10 billion points of color, but none of them ever coalesce into anything because they're coming from everywhere at the same time, if that makes any sense at all to anybody. If the internet and Twitter and all social media was a song, what would it sound like? You know, first of all, you'd have to have 10,000 guitars playing at the same time, 10,000 drums playing at the same time, 10,000 oboes playing at the same time, 10,000, it's a million things, saxophones, I mean, horns, everything. And it would be a cacophony, and then it would be the rare person that could hear within all of that. But I really do believe you can pan for information gold in the midst of all of that noise. I think the real clever approach is to teach kids to parse that. To parse that and to make information come to them on their terms. Now, I can do this with Google. I do this with, I set up, what am I saying here? Google. Sorry, guys, I'm so all over the place here, but I'm trying to open up my mind to really consider all these things. Google. Maps, translate, classroom, nope. Google. See more. Let's go to. Hold on, guys. I talk about this every day. I don't know. You ever sit down and try to have ideas and suddenly you can't remember anything because you're trying to? Google. Let's go back to Google. Go to more. Maps, activity drive. Oops. Someone got something on here. Okay, someone just helped me. Someone just put that part of my brain back in there. You set it up so that Google researches the things you're looking for. So you go in there and you put in a key term. You can even put in your own name and quotation marks, and Google will search for that for you all the time until you shut it off. And it will give you a link in your email to where it found that thing. All right. And I'm showing people this all the time, and for some reason it's not popping in there. But if you're using this all the time, then you've got people looking for things for you, and information is becoming the thing that you use. Information is becoming a thing that you paint with, if you're getting the colors to come to you, right? Or the information to come to you, or the research to come to you. I love this as a time saver. And I love anybody who's out there trying to build a tool to help us parse this all of this noise so that everything we do isn't a cacophony of every possibility at the same time. Okay, so on that creativity front. So the Cars is playing around with 8 notes and they're doing just what I needed. Just what I needed, right? And so suddenly 38 Specials, Jeff Carlisi hears the Cars and he will say he did not like the Cars. He did not like those 8th notes. He found it disconcerting, I think, in the early days. And then after he heard those songs for a while, he started to like them. It's interesting how a musician can do that. But then suddenly he hears that, and he hears this in his head. Now, what is it? I don't mind you coming round. wasting all my... What he does is... You see it all around you. You see it all around you. Good living gone bad. And usually it's too late. He heard something else in the same chords. So he was being creative within the same chords, right? So it wasn't that he needed all the freedom in the world. In fact, he put his teeth into something that already existed and built onto it, right? So be careful when you're making your definition of what creativity is or can be, or under what conditions it can exist. I think it can exist under any conditions. I think the most important thing is that we value it, that we seek to understand it, and we look for it in our children. And please understand, every kid that came through my art class wasn't endlessly creative when I met them. Often they were copiers of what they saw as interesting or creative. They were Disney tracers. And many of them thought I didn't know that what they were tracing there wasn't from a Disney movie. Of course I know those visual images, but I don't call them on those things. I figure if they can first wear that, right, that Disney thing, trace those lines, whatever, then they can move beyond that. Maybe they learn their methods and principles, their early beginnings of the human body and anatomy aren't wrongly spent on using Disney as a model, because those Disney animators are pretty freaking amazing. They look at a human form or look at how to make a lion anthropomorphic. That's pretty sophisticated thinking. So if kids can do that, now does it matter that they know how they did it? Eventually, probably. But I think when they get older, they can find out. I don't think every kid needs to know every secret of everything as they're doing it. I think it's okay if they think there's magic involved, and later on they find out there was actually a methodology in place here. And that's how they got to it, right? And me, as the encourager of creativity, I think I want a room that has, and I always built a room like this. I had clay, right? Not every clay in the world. I had a cone 5 earthenware white and cone 5 earthenware red. I'd like to have had more clay. I also had a budget. I had 50 colors. This is my proudest point, 50 colors of glaze. Kids in my ceramics class, and there was a ceramics class, and it was the same room with my drawing class, and the same room with my watercolor and painting class, and the same room with my jewelry and metalsmithing class. So I had a few tools for each of these things. And I could vision so many more tools. But you only have so much money. So you gotta get the biggest bang for your buck. What can kids make with the stuff that you have? That's my job, is to go out and find out where I can find stuff for the cheapest price. These days, it's amazing what you can find and what you can do. In metalsmithing class back in those days, kids would make, I did lost wax casting. So kids would sculpt wax, green wax. I used mostly green wax, sometimes softer wax, blue wax, but green, a lot of times the hard green wax. Kids would file it and file it and file it and make a shape. And of course we'd sketch the shape from the front, from the top, from the side, try to get an understanding of what this thing looked like in 3D. And this is old school. This is pre-software. This is pencil and paper. And then the kids would make this thing. Jared Schrag, one of the best art kids I ever had in class. I hope you still make stuff. Hey, Russ Kale, I miss you too, brother. Jared, you're amazing. In fact, Jared, I believe you're the one that said, okay, so, okay, I had these lamps in my room. They were aluminum lamps, and I inherited some of them. And you point them at still lifes to get certain kinds of shadows so kids can practice shadows on things like cones and cubes and cylinders and apples and pears and bananas and blah, 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 what have you. So these are fairly cheap lights, and you buy them and they last a certain amount of time. Anyway, they have three legs. They have three legs that come down, and you can adjust the three legs so that it stands up straight, and then they kind of fold like this. You put them back in the cabinet. So Jared Schrag is looking at my lamps one day, and I was, okay, three legs coming off. They had rivets, a rivet, and a rivet. Well, when I came to the job, one of the lamps was missing a rivet, so they hadn't used it in a long time. So I just took a fork and stuck the fork tine through the rivet hole, and I bent it back so that that was bent, and there were two prongs sticking up there, and we used it for a long time. Jared is this kid. He looks at that and goes, you know, that's a terrible waste of two prongs. And I laughed, because in a million years, I wouldn't have thought of that, in a million years. So how's creativity changing? Right? How could creativity change? I'm interested in how it's changing, especially when It helps me be able to do more things for less money, and it gets kids aligned to the changing ways the world lets people create. Those two things have to go together for me to be interested. So that's where I get interested in some things like Shapeways.com. I don't work for them, I don't get any money from them, blah, 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 blah. I just noticed them along with a couple of other companies that let kids design things in software and then print them in 3D. So an example. There's a kid that I know that I still call him a kid. I think he's 24 now. He might be 25. I'm not sure. His name is Nathan. And Nathan is one of the best 3D designers I've ever seen. And I've seen a lot of people. He's very humble, so he would never agree with that. Anyway, he designs things in 3D, and then I work with him to get those things made. On Shapeways.com, I encouraged him to go out there and do that. So one of the things I had him do, I want you to Google right now. I'll help you spell it, okay? Antikythera mechanism. So let's spell that. Antikythera mechanism. Antikythera mechanism, okay? Okay, and now look at that, okay? And someone should get a good look at what that looks like. I asked Nathan if he could make me a design in software of the Antikythera mechanism. Get it on your screen. Get it on your screen so you're looking at the Antikythera mechanism. And then once he did that, I asked him if he could get an account over on Shapeways.com and put his design on there so I could buy it and wear it as a pendant. Now back in the high school art classroom, I might have had you do this, and you'd have done this in green wax. And then if you were really good at this, let's see if I can get this clear here. Now if you're looking at a picture of this on your screen that you found that's from a museum, you'll notice that this is pretty darn close, right? On the back he signs it, there's his signature. So here's a young man who has taken software, designed something really cool, but now that we've put this thing online where people can find it, right, we can sell 10,000 units this quarter. We could sell 100,000. So back in my way, we could make one, and in making that, we broke the mold. Look, the same skill sets are in play here as there were when my kids were making things in green wax. Not so much this, it's a little more this, but they're still creating, right, with the tools of now. Would I like kids to be able to sculpt and use software? Absolutely. I call that tradigital art. And I want kids to have those twin skills. But I want them to have some skills one way or another. So I go and buy this, right? So Nathan can sell these things worldwide now. And I can buy them in 40 materials. This is steel with gold plate. But I could also buy it in pewter, bronze, plastic, glass, brass, polished brass, gold-plated brass, 40 materials. Can you imagine what it would cost in the old days to have these made and shipped all over the world? And now that I can tell you that we can do it for free, that's a very interesting time for me to be talking to kids and mentoring kids and encouraging kids, right? Because we have these new tools and we can do things we could never do before. I find all of this very interesting, very interesting. Colette, it's so good to see you. It's been a while since I was out in your place. I'm trying to get this thing set up so that, what is this? I was holding the yellow cat, now I've got yellow cat hair all over me. Hold on, I'm going to bend this here. Put this here. Okay. I feel like I'm doing a fireside chat. It's like Harry Truman or something. Got the fireplace in the background. Because I was doing creativity, I wanted to include my painting in the background. I have another one over here. I have an actual sculpture over here that's a little bit different. I'm going to turn this and see if you can see it. Mm-hmm. That's a sculpture I did. This was sort of inspired by Louise Nevelson, who does these sort of shadow box sculptures with all kinds of different objects in them. So what she does is she neutralizes all these shapes and turns them into pure form that people can look at and appreciate. So, you know, you find macrame up here. These are pine needles. I'm juxtaposing a light bulb with a skull, basically showing you that this skull is not unlike this light bulb, and it's a total accident from industrialists who totally organic. Broken glass and the way it breaks, right? Making a study of just that. These are shower curtain hooks, right? And put all together like this, they actually take on another meaning. It's just a basket that I've cut up here, a stapler, all kinds of sort of inane everyday objects here turned into something. And this thing that they're all framed in is an 1890s window frame that was being thrown away. And I thought it was way too important a form to allow to be thrown away when it could actually hold something interesting. So I guess you can tell a lot about a person by what they value. And so one of the things I value that for my own child and my own children is creativity, is music, is visual art, is poetry, is writing. My wife and I do a lot to make sure kids have access to things that inspire them. And we've watched as they've grown up. If you know my son Ben at all, his book that's coming out pretty soon, Bleak is called, is the product of years of research and work on his part. Is it creative? I think it's amazingly creative. And it's the product of all kinds of inputs. For instance, all the shows that he likes on TV, all the music he listens to, all of that becomes the flotsam and the jetsam of what becomes the work of his. He sort of swims in this and then comes out and writes with what he's acquired. Almost fills his pen with the elixir of what he allows to inspire him. That's not to say that every artist needs to be inspired by a million people to create anything. I think there are artists who are unique, who they just seem to come out of nowhere, self-taught, and they define some sort of outlying edge of an aesthetic. I find all those people fascinating. I think they're rare, and they're hard to, I think, mentor, because every time you try to mentor them, you're injecting something into that kid's equation. And what makes them interesting is the fact they don't have a blueprint. They are their own blueprint. I don't think everyone can do that. I think a lot of us have to get a whole bunch of foundational stuff under us, and then we can build with all of that stuff that we found. Again, what I want you to do here in this here, I know people are going to watch this after the fact. I'd like this to become a document, a collaborative document. Here I am doing all the talking. I don't want this to be just me talking. What I want to do here is, if you know an article or a blog post, or you wrote one, or you want to make a YouTube response video, whatever it is, drop that link here in this timeline and talk a little bit about what you think. Number one, what is creativity? Can it be taught? Can it be encouraged? Can it be grown in people? Is it important? Is it important that schools encourage creativity? Does the American culture need creativity? In what ways have we been creative in the past that defined us as a nation, as a country? Does the future need creativity? And where are these creative people coming from? How are we growing them? Are you creative? And if so, how? How are you creative? Who helped you become creative, or were you born that way? What is it that makes creativity? I'm going to bring this in for a landing in a weird way here. Here's how I think of creativity, personally, okay? I call it fishing in the ether. Stick with me for a moment, okay? I'm going to get weird. The ether is everything that's possible. The things I can build, right? The things I can make. Anything is possible. And the thing that's interesting now is that the world is changing so quickly that things that are possible are changing quickly. I couldn't do this yesterday, now I can do 3D printing. I couldn't do 3D printing in metal, now I can. A week later, I can. So that means knowing enough about the way the world is working and the way the world is changing that you can consider all the new tools within the ether, right? So now I'm fishing. And what does it mean, fishing? I am fishing with a line and a hook that represents a challenge, an opportunity, something that most of the time is something someone else has asked me to help them with. But sometimes it's me going, there should be a thing that does this. There should be a thing that does that. Why isn't there a this? It's not always earth-changing ideas. Sometimes it's, I want to find a way to hold my phone without my hands. Something beyond a selfie stick so I can have a talk walking through the airport while I have my hands free. I want to invent that. If someone hasn't already made it, if they've made it, I'll buy it. If they haven't, I'll partner with someone to make it. But I think more people than me probably need this thing. So now I go fishing in the ether. So I'm looking down there at multiple levels. There's a jeweler that could make it. There's a woodwright that could make it. There's a person who works in plastics and exotic materials that could make it. There's an entrepreneur in California that's almost made it. Somewhere in that ether, I'm going to find the right combination of things to get that thing built. And once that thing is built, something new is in the world that wasn't there before. So that's sort of an entrepreneurial creativity model that I have. And so the only way my ether is effective is if it's current, is if my ether includes the new tools. So my worry is that we stay too long in one tool set and the world has gone beyond us and we're going to get caught flat-footed by a world that just has outsourced or gone around all the old ways. And that's not to say there won't still be a market for your handmade wooden stuff on Etsy. You'll still sell a bunch. But to ignore social media and all the people that could work together with you to be collaborative, to help you be creative these days, would be, I think, unwise. I think it's important to stay open-minded, to keep your canvas big, and to keep your palette expansive, right? That maybe it's all oil paint, but it's all some digital. Or there's an app on your iPad that you use for painting too, and you do some of your painting there, right? Whatever it is. I hope that we're looking for ways to let kids be creative in school. I hope that we are supporting the creative classes where it's always been our job to make sure kids are supported as they attempt to attempt creativity, and we try to foster that. I think if you cut all of those classes, it's gonna be really hard for kids to find a safe place to be creative. So as parents and as grandparents, as advocates, I think it's important that our two cents worth goes in with regard to creativity and what we think is important to save the arts classes, the visual arts class, the music classes, the classes where kids do composition, the schools that are allowing kids to be creative in the context of STEM and STEAM. We gotta stand there and applaud. We can't support those with silence. We've got to actually make noise, because the people who don't believe that's important, they're talking. And if those of us who do think it's important aren't talking, then even good things can die. Even right things can die. I'm going to keep having this conversation, and next week I'm going to be on Twitter doing a bit of a chat on Twitter, and let's see here if I can find it. Let's see, look for it here too. I ran into these other art teachers, these other crazies out there, and I'm honored to get to be on their chat because they've done so much to build a great community out there on chat. Let me see here, darn it. K-12 Art Chat is the hashtag, K-12 Art Chat. And I believe this is Laura Grundler, yep, and her husband that do this here. So my theme is going to be divergent thinking, and that's how to go from this is what I've been taught to this is what I've learned since then. This is what I've learned on my own. This is what I've invented in terms of a new approach that no one taught me. But it's a combination of all the things I've been taught. What is divergent thinking today? And how do we foster divergent thinking? So I'll be asking 5 questions and looking for your response on Twitter. That's 8:17 at 8:30 p.m. Central Standard Time. I hope that you're there for that conversation. I will see you next time. Thanks for watching.